Hello students, in this presentation we are going to see in detail about JavaScript array, objects, DOM, that is document object model, promises and callback. Consider what is an array. So we use array whenever we want to create and store a list of multiple items in a single variable. Arrays are specially useful when creating ordered collections, where items in the collection can be accessed by their numerical position in the list. Just as the object properties can store the values of any primitive data type like array or any another object, so array can also consist of strings, numbers, booleans, objects or even other arrays. We can say that array is a special variable which can hold more than one value at a time. So for example, if you have a list of items like you have a list of car names. So storing the cars in a single variable will be this way, where car 1 is equal to Alto, where car 2 is equal to Volvo, where car 3 is equal to BMW. However, if you have more than 400 thousands of car names you want to store, so we have the solution as array. So array can hold many values under a single name, and you can access the values by referring to the index number. So now how to create the array? So using an array literal is the easiest way for creating JavaScript array. Consider its syntax, where array name is equal to in square bracket item 1 comma item 2. So total number of items that you want will be there in square bracket completed. For example, where cars is equal to in double quotes Alto comma Volvo comma BMW. You can create an empty array by following syntaxes: let array is equal to new array, or let array is equal to empty square brackets, that is empty array. Almost all the time the second syntax is used. We can supply initial elements in the bracket. For example, let fruits is equal to apple, orange, plum. Array elements are numbered starting with 0. We can get an array element by its number in square brackets. Let fruits is equal to apple, comma, orange, comma, plum. If you say alert fruits of 0, so output will be apple. If you say alert fruits of 1, output will be orange. That way, we can replace an element. Fruits of 2 is equal to pear. So now your array will become apple, orange, pear. Or you can add a new element to the array. Fruits of 3 is equal to lemon. Now the array becomes apple, orange, pear and lemon. The total number of elements in the given array is called as its length. For example, consider the array. Let fruits is equal to apple, comma, orange, comma, plum. If you say alert fruits.length, then output will be 3, because there are 3 elements in the array fruits. We can also use alert to show the whole array. If you say let fruits is equal to apple comma orange comma plum, and if you say alert fruits, then output will be apple comma orange comma plum. Consider another example. If you say alert let fruits is equal to banana, let array is equal to fruits. That means what we have done in this case, two variables are referring to the same array. If you say alert array double equal to fruits, means we are checking if array is equal to fruits, then output will be true. If you say array dot push pair, okay, and if you say alert fruits, so what will be the output? Banana comma pear, as we have pushed, that means we have added one element into the array fruits. We can include a mixture of different data types within the array. We can even include objects within it. For example, where names is equal to Sam comma Billy comma 24 comma 80. Consider various JavaScript array methods. The first one is pushing. The push method adds new element to the array that will be added at the end of the array. Consider for example, fruits array, where fruits is equal to banana, orange, apple, mango. We have stored four elements in fruits array. If we say fruits.push in bracket kiwi, so it will add new element kiwi to fruits. The push method returns the new array length. For example, if we say where fruits is equal to banana, orange, apple, mango, if we say where x is equal to fruits.push in bracket kiwi. So what we have done? We have added kiwi into fruits array. So x will return 5 because previously there were 4 elements in fruits array and now we have added one element, that is kiwi. So x will return 5. Consider another method, that is pop method. So it removes last element from the array. Consider the same array where fruits is equal to banana, orange, apple, mango. If we say fruits.pop, so it will remove the last element, which is mango, from fruits. The pop method returns the value that was popped out. For example, if we say where fruits is equal to banana, orange, apple, mango, and where x is equal to fruits.pop, so the value of x is mango because we have popped it out. Consider how to delete the elements from the array. Since JavaScript arrays are objects, elements can be deleted by using JavaScript operator delete. Consider the same array where fruits is equal to banana, orange, apple, mango. So we can say delete fruits of 1. So as you know, array index starts from 0. So at 0th location, banana is there, and at 1st location, orange is there. So using delete may leave undefined holes in the array, so better you use pop or shift. Consider now how to merge the array. So merging is nothing but concatenating. So the concat method creates a new array by merging existing arrays. Consider, for example, where f1 is equal to in square bracket ab comma cd, in another array, that is f2, ef, gh, ij, these three elements we have stored. If we say where new list is equal to f1.concat in bracket f2. So what we have done? We have concatenated f1 and f2 array. So the output will be ab, comma cd, ef, gh, ij. All elements of f1 and f2 will be concatenated. Consider what is objects in JavaScript. So objects in JavaScript, as like many other programming languages, can be compared to objects in real life. The concept of objects in JavaScript can be understood with real life tangible objects. In JavaScript, object is a standalone entity with the properties and type. Compare it with a cup, for example. So cup is an object with the properties. Cup has a color, it has a design, it has a weight, material it is made up of, etc. The same way, JavaScript objects can have the properties which define their characteristics. An object is a collection of properties, and a property is an association between name, or we say it as a key, and a value. A property's value can be a function, in which case the property is known as a method. Consider now objects and properties. JavaScript object has properties associated with it, as we have seen. A property of an object can be explained as a variable that is attached to the object. Object properties are basically the same as ordinary JavaScript variables, except for the attachment to objects. The properties of object define the characteristics of the object. You access the properties with a simple dot notation. For example, consider the syntax object name dot property name. Like all JavaScript variables, both the object name and property name are case sensitive. You can define a property by assigning it a value. For example, let's create an object that name it as my car and give it the properties like make, model, and year as follows. Where my car is equal to new object. By using this, we have created a new object, that is my car. My car dot make is equal to Ford. mycar.model is equal to Figo, mycar.year is equal to 2012. The above example can also be written by using object initializer, which is a comma delimited list of zero or more pairs of property names and associated values of the object enclosed in curly brackets. For example, where my car is equal to in bracket make colon Ford, model colon Figo, year colon 2012. Properties of JavaScript objects can also be accessed or set by using a bracket notation. Objects are sometimes called as associative arrays because each property is associated with a string value that can be used to access it. So for example, you could access the properties of the mycar object as follows. Mycar of make is equal to Ford. Mycar of model is equal to Figo, like that. An object property name can be any valid JavaScript string or anything that can be converted to the string, including the empty string. So consider, for example, let school is equal to name colon Sarada School, location colon Nasik, display info colon function in bracket console dot log, the value of key location is dollar school of location. Now say consider school dot display info, that means we are calling the function display info. So the output of the above will be the value of the key location is Nasik. Consider how to define the methods. As we have seen, a method is a function associated with the object, or simply put, a method is a property of the object that is a function. Methods are defined the way normal functions are defined, except that they have to be assigned as the property of the object. For example, object name dot method name is equal to function name, where my object is equal to my method colon function in bracket put the parameters, then whatever function that you want to write, so put that in brackets. Or this can also be done, my other method in bracket parameters begin and end, in that whatever you want to do in the function you write that. Where object name is the existing object, method name is the name you are assigning to the method, and function name is the name of the function. You can then call the method in the context of the object as follows, object.methodName in bracket parameters. Consider the example, let person is equal to first name colon John, last name colon Doe. Person.greet is equal to function. In that, we are writing console.log hello world. If you call the function person.greet, the output will be hello world. In this example, we added a function expression to create the function and assigned it to the property greet of the person object. Then we call the function via the greet property as greet. When a function is a property of an object, it is called as a method. Now consider about JavaScript document object. So the document object represents the whole HTML document. When HTML document is loaded in the browser, it becomes a document object. It is the root element that represents the HTML document. It has properties and methods. By the help of document object, we can add dynamic contents to our web page. Every web page resides inside a browser window, which can be considered as an object. A document object represents the HTML document that is displayed in that window. The document object has various properties that refer to other objects, which allow access to and modification of document content. The way a document content is accessed and modified is called as document object model. That is DOM. The objects are organized in a hierarchy. This hierarchical structure applies to the organization of objects in a web document. Consider what is window object. The top of the hierarchy, it is the outermost element in the object hierarchy. Document object, each HTML document has loaded into a window becomes a document object. The document contains the contents of that page. Form object, everything that is enclosed in form tag, that is form up to slash form tag, sets the form object. Form control elements, the form object contains all the elements defined for that object, such as text field, buttons, radio buttons, and checkboxes. There are several DOMs in existence. The following sections explain each of these DOM in detail and describe how you can use them to access and modify the document content. First one is the legacy DOM. This is the model which was introduced in early versions of JavaScript language. It is well supported by all browsers but allow the access only to certain key portions of the documents, such as forms, form element, and images. The W3C DOM, this document object model allows the access and modification of all document content, and it is standardized by World Wide Web Consortium, that is W3C. This model is supported by almost all the modern browsers. IE4 DOM, this document object model was introduced in version 4 of Microsoft Internet Explorer browser. IE5 and later versions include support for most basic W3C DOM features. Consider various methods of document object. We can access and change the contents of document by its methods. The important methods of document object are as follows. Consider the first method, that is write. If we say write in bracket string, so it writes the given string on the document. Writeln string, so it writes the given string on the document with new line character at the end. GetElementById returns the element having the given ID value. GetElementByName returns all the elements having the given name value. GetElementsByTagName returns all the elements having the given tag name. GetElementByClassName returns all the elements having given class name. Now consider how to access field value by document object. So in this example, we are going to get the value of input text by user. Here we are using document.form1.name.value to get the value of the name field. Here document is the root element that represents HTML document. Form1 is the name of the form. Name is the attribute name of the input field. Value is the property that returns the value of the input text. Let's see the simple example of document object that prints name with welcome message. We will write a script. Consider the function print value. In that we are defining a variable name is equal to document.form1.name.value. So as we have described, so it is used to get the value of the name field. Alert, the message welcome plus name slash script. In the form, we are saying name is equal to form1, that is the name of the form. Enter name, input type is equal to text, name is equal to name. Input type is equal to button, on click, print value. Function we are calling value is equal to print name and slash form. So it will simply print the name with welcome message. Consider a very important concept, that is callback. Now, to understand this concept, I will give one simple example. Suppose that we are talking on the phone, and when talking, sometimes it may happen that we put the call on hold so that we can do whatever urgent work we have to finish. And once we finish that, we return to the call that we left on hold. So that is a callback. So simply with this example, we can give an idea in general what is a callback. Basically, as the name says, it is. Now consider about the programming language. Callback is a function that will be executed when a synchronous operation has been completed. A callback is passed as an argument to the asynchronous operation. Normally, this is passed as the last argument of the function. Doing this, it's a good practice. So, always remember that. The callback structure is like this. Function, say hello. Console.log will put a message, hello everyone. Set timeout, in bracket, we will call the function, say hello, comma, 3000. So, what we did in the above example is, first we have defined a function that prints a message to the console. After that, we use a timer called as set time out. This timer is a native JavaScript function. Now this timer is a synchronous operation that executes callback after a certain time. So in our example, 3000 milliseconds, that is after 3 seconds, will be executed the say hello function. Now consider what is a callback pattern. As we mentioned at the beginning, so we respect the callback position as a parameter, which should always be placed as the last one. This has for the name the callback pattern. In this way, our code will be more readable and will be maintained more easily when other programmers work on it. For JavaScript to know when a synchronous operation has a result being either returned data or an error that occurred during the operation. It points to a function that will be executed once that result is ready. This function is a callback function. We have already seen that. Meanwhile, JavaScript continues its normal execution of code. This is why frameworks that does external calls of different kinds have APIs where you provide callback functions to be executed later on. Registering the event listener in a browser with add event listener, reading a file content with fs.readfile, or registering a middleware in an express web server with server.use are some examples of common APIs that use callbacks. Here is an example of fetching the data from URL using a module called as request. Consider the example, constant request is equal to require in bracket request. Request in bracket http://www.somepage.com, for example, comma function error comma response comma body. If error, handle that error, else successful, so do something with the result. So as you can see, request takes a function as its last argument. This function is not executed together with the code above. It is saved to be executed later once the underlying IO operation of fetching the data over HTTP is done. The underlying HTTP request is an asynchronous operation and does not block the execution of the rest of the JavaScript code. The callback function is put on a sort of queue called as event loop until it will be executed with a result from the request. We will consider one more example of callback. Constant fs is equal to require in bracket fs. We are importing a Node.js library. Now we are declaring a file path this way. Constant file path is equal to .users.json. Now consider fs.readfile in bracket file path function on read file error comma result. The asynchronous operation to read the file. Now in case of error, print it on the console this way. If error, then print it. Console.log, there was an error, plus error and return. Now print the file and content of it on the console. This way, console.log, the file was successfully read, plus result. Now here we are using a Node.js library that is used to make the operations on our file system. In the example, we are using the read file function that works to read a file from our computer. This function receives two parameters, the file path and the callback. As we can notice, the callback named on read file. it is found as the last parameter. It is common for the callback to be declared anonymously, but it is good practice to assign it a name in case of an error to identify it more easily. Finally, the callback will be executed until our code finishes reading the requested file. JavaScript will continue to execute the code during this process if it exists. Consider the next concept, that is callback hell. Callbacks are a good way to declare what will happen once an IO operation has a result. But what if you want to use that data in order to make another request? You can only handle the result of the request within the callback function provided. In this example, the variable result will not have a value when printed to the console at the last line. Consider the example, constant request is equal to require request. Let result request in bracket http://www.somepage.com function error, response, body. If error, handle that error, else result is equal to body. console.log in bracket result. The last line will output undefined to the console because at the time that line is being executed, the callback has not been called. Even if the request were somehow to complete before the result variable is printed to the console, this code still run to the completion before the callback is executed anyway, because that is the nature of the non-blocking IO model in JavaScript. So if we want to do a second request based on the result of a first one, we have to do it inside the callback function of the first request, because that is where the result will be available. Consider what are promises. The promises in JavaScript are just that, promises. We know that when we make a promise, it means that we will do everything possible to achieve the expected result. But we also know that a promise cannot always be fulfilled for some reason. Just as a promise in real life is, it is in JavaScript represented in another way in code. A promise is an object that wraps an asynchronous operation and notifies when it's done. This sounds exactly like callbacks, but the important differences are in the usage of promises. Instead of providing a callback, a promise has its own method which you call to tell the promise what will happen when it is successful or when it fails. The method a promise provides are then for when a successful result is available and catch for when something went wrong. Using a promise this way looks like this. Some asynchronous operation in bracket some parameters dot then function result. So do something with the result dot catch function error, so it will handle the error. One important side note here is that some asynchronous operation in bracket some parameter is not a promise itself, but a function that returns a promise. Consider an example of a promise. Let promise is equal to new function resolve, reject. If everything turn out to be fine, then resolve stuff worked. Else, for some reason the promise doesn't fulfill, then reject new error, it broke. A promise is a native class of JavaScript. The constructor of a promise receives an argument, a callback, which has two parameters, resolve and reject. These are the functions already defined in JavaScript, so we should not build them ourselves. This callback, which has these two functions as parameters, is called as the executor. The executor runs immediately when a promise is created. What is this executor function going to execute? So well, within this, we will put all the code necessary for our promises to be fulfilled. Once the executor finishes executing, we will send one of the functions that it has as an argument. In case it is fulfilled, we use the resolve function. In case it fails, for some reason, we use the reject function. The functions resolve and reject receive only one argument. It is common for the reject function to pass an error with the error class. As we saw in the previous example, promises have three unique states: pending, fulfilled, and rejected. Pending is the asynchronous operation has not been completed yet. Fulfilled, the asynchronous operation that has completed and returns a value. Rejected, it is an asynchronous operation which is failed and the reason why it is failed is indicated. The promise object has two properties, state and result. State indicates the state of the promise and result stores the value of the promise if it is fulfilled or the error if it is rejected. Initially, the state of a promise is pending and the result is undefined. Once the promise has finished its execution, the status and result of the promise will be modified to the corresponding value, depending on whether the promise was completed or rejected. Now, as we have seen the callback and promises with examples, the main difference between them is that with callback, you tell the executing function what to do when a synchronous task completes. Whereas with promise, the executing function returns a special object to you, that is the promise. And then you tell the promise what to do when the asynchronous task completes. Thank you.